Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. I'm Relix, and today we're going to go over the LA Kings and Boston Bruins game for game two of the season for the Kings. Still on the road. I believe it's six straight games on the road to start the season before the home opener. And just like the last game, I felt the Kings were, as I used in that video, disconnected. The passing was a little bit better than it was in the Sabres game, but it was still not to the point where they were making good passes to connect on plays to get the offense going. Hence the reason why this game ended up being a very close one goal difference, 2-1 win for Boston, and it was in overtime. So that's the bright side, is the fact that it went into overtime. The Kings got the point against an Eastern team, which doesn't matter, so perfectly fine in that regard. However, I'm not seeing enough offense from the Kings here in this game, especially against a much stronger Boston team than the Sabres. Overall, I'm not trying to downplay the Buffalo team at all, but the Boston team is definitely a much stronger team. They've always been a strong playoff contender, and so the Kings going into their second game against Boston, I'm actually okay with the result. Like I said, losing is, you know, not good, but we got the overtime point, and that's what really matters. The Bruins, for the most part, the teams were even throughout the most of the game, but going into the third period and then into overtime, it was pretty much all Bruins. The occasional Kings chances on the power play or whatnot, but overall, it was mostly for the Bruins' favor. Moore got the first goal for the LA Kings. It was a strong power play performance, and I believe the goal came just right after the penalty ended for the Bruins, therefore resulting in no power play goals. Second unit definitely had it going more than the first unit did, going even back to the first game as well against the Sabres, and even into preseason. Preseason, I thought the power play was pretty terrible, and going to the first two games of the regular season, it still needs a lot of work. However, overall, it was okay for the second unit today. First unit needs work. PK, though, solid performance as far as defense is concerned. Much better than the first game. Problem is, we still took five penalties, resulting in five PKs, as well as, the difference being we didn't take a 5-on-3 PK like we did in the Sabres game, but we still had two early penalties in the game against. So Kemper coming up big. Best player for the Kings by far was Kemper again, as well as for the Bruins. Swayman was definitely their player of the game, and I am one of those guys who don't think Swayman deserves his contract. I don't think he is a proven goaltender yet. However, based on tonight's performance, he did a really good job. Not saying it was the best, because I don't think the Kings played their best game yet, but it was still a strong performance by the goaltenders overall. Let's go over the LA Kings stats, for the recap of the game. I'm going to do something a little different from the first game. Here's a recap of the first intermission. Shots on goal, 9-7 in favor of the Kings. However, faceoffs, not so good. And, of course, we took those two early penalties. Followed by the, game stats, penalties, hits, block shots, giveaways, takeaways. Overall, nothing's too surprising. Bruins are a bigger team, so they should be out-hitting us, no problem. But overall, still an even game after the first period. I want to say I was quite bored in the first period. I was like, come on, where's all the good action? Let's go. Going to the second period, take a look at the faceoffs first. After the first intermission, because of the penalties and then, of course, the way the Kings are structured, only two centermen took faceoffs. Roman Fogel has 100% on the faceoffs. However, he isn't a centerman, so he probably came in and took that faceoff. I believe it was only one faceoff. Otherwise, Kopi and Danault took all the faceoffs, and that needs to change. Again, without Blake Lizotte on the team now, that's one less centerman that the Kings are going to rely on to take all the faceoffs. Byfield is the centerman for the third line. However, with the PKs, as soon as PK is over, they want Byfield's line out there to help, the other guys rest up a little bit. But as soon as we're done, we're going back right on the PK. So needs to fix that going to future games. But after the first two periods, here's your stats for the second intermission. Again, Kings are still out shooting the Bruins. Not bad, overall. But again, those faceoffs got even worse and that's something that needs to be improved upon. Overall, still a very even game, more or less. We still took two more penalties in this period, and then, of course, Bruins took three, but overall, the Kings' performance was not, you know, perfect, and that needs to really improve. Faceoffs being results in Deneau and Kopitar being the only two centermen taking any faceoffs in the game so far. And again, that's a problem that needs to be fixed. Turcotte's on the fourth line as well, but apparently the Kings do not trust Turcotte to take faceoffs. Obviously, not many icings either. So, you know, in the end, the Kings need to win these faceoffs. They need to get out of the zone, break out, and convert on the offense. Final results of the stats were Kings' favor of shots throughout the entire game, but Swayman proved to be the better goaltender. Faceoffs were never in the Kings' favor. And, of course, both teams did not capitalize on any of their power plays. Granted, like I said, Moore's goal came just as the power play ended. So, technically, it could have been counted as one, but either way, it still did not count. So, we need to get more power play goals into the net. And then, of course, overall, I think the Bruins played a much more defensive game than the Kings did. So, block shots played a huge part. And then, of course, the final results in the face-offs. We did take a few more face-offs. Byfield had a couple. Lewis, Fogle even took another one. But again, Kopi and Deneau doing most of the work needs to improve on their face-off percentages. So overall, you know, it's kind of impressive that we were only able to do that with two centermen. But at the same time, it's also kind of dumb because we should be relying on all four lines and getting the work done. As for my notes for the by periods, Kings PK starts with two quick penalties. That's not good. That needs to change. The only good thing is the Bruins only got one shot, and the Kings pushed the offense aggressively on the PK throughout the entire game, resulting in three shots in that first couple kills, which is really nice. Darcy Kuemper, again, having to be alert early with the two penalties, as well as all the opportunities the Bruins were getting. Their chances were much better than the Kings as far as rating-wise. But Kuemper, early to the game, and you know, it's getting his saves in. Fantastic once again, hands down, best player for the Kings again, just like Swayman was for the Bruins. Overall, not the worst start, but going into period two, obviously Kings power play, first goal. It wasn't on the power play, but the second it got done, all five Kings actually had a touch on that puck before it was scored by Moore on the rebound. So again, get pucks to the front of the net, you guys get some good goals. Brant Clark, again, too many penalties for the first couple games. He needs to be more disciplined. He needs to be a little bit better defensively as well. It's very disappointing. I've said it before, I'm not a big fan of how he has been playing the past few years since we drafted him. But he is still young, so hopefully things improve. This looks to be his first full season since Doughty is out. Mikey Anderson led to the first goal against, missed pass to Jordan Spence. The chemistry is not there between those two guys. Obviously, Spence never playing with Mikey, and then, of course, Doughty's out, so Mikey doesn't have his partner. The chemistry is not there. 4-on-4 is just not the Kings' thing, apparently, right now, and it led to the first goal against for the Bruins. Very disconnected play. Overall, the Kings looked desperate towards the end of the second period, and I was actually thankful we got out of that period real quick, so going to the third period, Kings early power play, some good chances, but first unit still didn't look good compared to the second unit. A lot of neutral zone battles between both teams, and the Bruins end up having more chances than the Kings in the final period, resulting in a foreshadow for the overtime, where in the end the Kings had more possession, but the Bruins capitalized a lot more on their opportunities, especially with the Kings being tired and not changing out when they should be, or even taking the time to just backtrack, let Kuemper help you guys out, and you know, he can play the puck while you guys go change. Kings used to be the best team in overtime when 3-on-3 was first introduced. However, that is no longer the case. In fact, Kings lose a lot in overtime, and that's unfortunate because we do have, in my opinion, the stronger team than the Bruins in overtime, but misplays led up to the goal against. So by Pastrnak. Final notes, Kempe missed shots equals chances for Bruins. Actually, fine. Actually, good. Second unit for the power play was good. Needs more organization from the net for more rebounds, but Overice looked good. Kemper was fantastic. PK was not the cleanest, but looked aggressive and good kills, 5 for 5. And the bad power play, did not capitalize after 5 chances. Again, needs to capitalize even more. As I mentioned in my reviews from the past summer, even just one power play goal can make the difference in the game, and that one power play goal could have been the game winner for the Kings in this game, and in regulation, no less. Missed shots, missing the net, you know, with those shots, especially by Kempe. Kempe was probably my worst player of the night today. You miss those shots hard and wide. It swings the puck around the boards for the Bruins to counterattack. Very easy for them to get on the offense. That actually played a part in the overtime as well. Third period endurance didn't seem to be in the Kings' favor. You know, I get it, day game, not used to it. So, you know, hopefully they, you know, it's again, second game. So hopefully they pick things up a little bit more as the season goes along. And of course, the OT was just not good. Not connecting on the passes, not, you know, taking too many risks. They're passing it way too hard and out of reach of the other players, as well as not changing when they should be. So overall, the Kings didn't play to their best potential, but hey, it's a Bruins team. They're the better team. No, I don't deny that. And it's only the second game. So I only say that for so many games, though. Like, after, like, the 8th or 9th, 10th games, we're in full season now. You can't use that excuse anymore. It's no longer early. You got to get it going. And so, overall, I'm happy with the result. We got a point in overtime. That's what matters. But hopefully we can keep it going and, you know, continue to either win games, get points in overtime, or whatever it may be. We need to pick up the offense a little bit, though. Next team is the Ottawa Senators. A little bit weaker team. No offense to Ottawa fans, but we should be able to win this game for sure. So that's it for now. Thank you guys for watching. Hope you guys have a great day. Like, comment, subscribe, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye-bye.